We've been thinking about this word, this idea of pure or purity. We've been recognizing that it's not something that we hear a lot about in our culture, in our world anymore. And almost in a sense, it feels like the tide and the creative ways of introducing impurity just keep growing and kind of keep flowing at us and toward us. And yet in this world that we live in, there is still a God who we learned about 2 weeks ago, this God who is holy, 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 the Lord God Almighty. Isaiah chapter 6 in the Old Testament declares this. The heavenly beings cry out, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. In Revelation chapter 4, New Testament, holy, 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 the heavenly beings cry out, is the Lord God Almighty who was and is to come. So there is this God who is three times holy. In the ancient world, that was the way you emphasized things. You said it again and again and again. And the only characteristic of God that's repeated three times in a row is his holiness. And then we talked last week about this baffling idea that that God who is holy, holy, holy says to you, says to me, be holy as I, the Lord your God, am holy. We're kind of knocked back on our heels, like, what are you talking about? How can we be holy as God is holy? And yet in Leviticus chapter 11, verse 44, in 1 Peter chapter 3, again, Old Testament, New Testament, that declaration is there from the heart of God. We are to be holy as God is holy. And so last week we talked about the reality. We had a chair right up here on the stage. And we talked about that reality that Jesus Christ came from heaven, God with us, Emmanuel, God with us. Jesus came and he died on the cross and he paid for our sins and he took our shame and he took the punishment we deserved. And Jesus became the final high priest and the final sacrifice you'll ever need. And Hebrews, the book of Hebrews says, and the New Testament says, and when he had made purification for sins, he, Jesus, it says, sat down at the right hand of the Father Almighty. He sat down to declare, it's finished, it's done, it's paid in full. So if you come to the cross and you receive Jesus Christ, the Bible says you're made holy because of Christ. You're washed clean of your sins because of Christ. And that is amazing good news. That's why the gospel is called the good news. Because of faith in Jesus, you can have all your sins washed away and you are made holy. But the story doesn't end there. But God also says, live a lifestyle of holiness. Grow in holiness. And I just noticed something. I'm going to have to hit the pause button. I have 27 minutes for my message. I have to have a timer counting down where I'm really supposed to be, or I will not know when to stop, and I'll preach all day long and we'll miss our baptisms. So give me a timer. Okay. So anyways, we're called to a lifestyle of holiness. If you don't know it, there's a clock back there, and it keeps me in line because I'll preach all day long if you let me. I got one person clap and give me an amen. Thank you. But there's another service after this one. And so God says, not only are we made holy at the cross, but we're to take up the cross. Jesus said, take up the cross every day, deny yourself, and follow me. So last week we had like a little workout area here talking about how growing in holiness is a workout. It's challenging. It's tough. It makes you ache and struggle. And there's times you wake up in the morning and go, I don't know if I want to work out today. Even when it comes to holiness. But God says, don't just come to the cross and receive my holiness, but grow in holiness. So how do we do that? I mean, how do we, in this world where the tide and the river of impurities is getting bigger and wider and faster, how do we swim against the tide? I want to share with you 12 different ideas, 12 different thoughts that I think will really help you in this journey of growing in holiness, of living in holiness. If you're a note taker, you'll find in your bulletin, there's a place for 12 ideas. If you're really smart, you can remember 3 or 4. If you really want to remember it, write these thoughts down so you can kind of go back to them and reflect on them and really say, God, I want to grow in holiness. So here's the question. How do I grow in the health and the wholeness of holiness? What God wants us to do is be spiritually healthy and whole. And we want that. We want to be healthy and whole. Well, the road to that is actually holiness. You want health in your life and you want wholeness in your life? Begin to walk the road of holiness. And the first step is this. Pray passionately for growth in holiness, confessing failures and struggles and the need for God's amazing grace and power. Just pray with passion. God, I long to be holy. I want to be holy. I want to grow in holiness. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 7, we read these words. For God did not call us to be impure, but to live a holy life. God says, if you're my child, if you're my follower, if you've come to Jesus and received him, you're made holy, but I haven't called you then to then go, just go, I'll just live my own way and live an impure life. But we're called to live a life of holiness. You know where it begins? Where that journey of holiness begins. And if you want to be anchored, if you're in that, remember last week that picture, I showed a little video of salmon swimming upstream. Upstream and up rocks and through the mouths of bears and trying to striving and striving. If you're gonna stand strong against this, the tide of all the impurity coming our way, guess what? Standing strong won't do it. You need to kneel strong. You need to kneel down. You want to get anchored where you're not going to get washed away by all the garbage of this world? Get down on your knees every day. And from this place, say, God, I want to be holy. I want a lifestyle of holiness. God, it is difficult. It is challenging. I feel that flood going against me, and I want to strive. And so I cry out to you for power and strength. Start here and cry out to God. And for some of you, you know what your first prayer needs to be? Here's your first prayer. God, I ask you to help me to actually want to be holy. Because for some people, you're like, you know, I came to the cross, I believe in Jesus, but I don't know if I really want to change my life very much. Then go back to the cross again and kneel down there and say, Jesus, remind me of the price you paid to wash me clean and give me power to walk in holiness. Number one, cry out to God. Grow me in holiness. Help me long for holiness. Help me on this journey. Number two, how do I grow in the health and the wholeness of holiness? Identify, name, and admit your sins. And commit to take all sins seriously, even the little sins, even the things that we want to call, what we want to call little sins, and the secret sins. Take all sin seriously. And don't take it lightly. Don't get comfortable with your sin. But say, God, help this matter to me. And then identify and name your sins. I love Psalm 51 where David has gone through this time of his life where he loved God. He sought the heart of God. He wrote great songs of worship to God. And he did a nosedive into sin. We're talking murder, adultery, coveting, and a bunch of other sins. I mean, big mess up in his life. And in Psalm 51, he begins to pour his heart out to God. And he prays this. For I know my transgressions. My sin is always before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what's evil in your sight. So you are right in your verdict and justified when you judge. David says, you know my sins, God. And here's what David says. And so do I. I admit my sins to you. Remember at the end of last week's message, talked about high places. In ancient Israel, they had these places that were places of profane, horrible worship, but they were there for so long, people didn't notice them anymore. And I encourage you to look at your own life and say, God, what are my high places, the places where there's sin and I hardly notice it anymore because it's been there so long and I've become so comfortable with it. See, I can't stand up here and say, here's the four things you need to change in your life to walk in holiness because I don't know where you're struggling. But I do know where I'm struggling. And God's speaking to my heart. And God's calling me to walk in holiness. So if you open your heart and say, God, I need to know and I need to be able to confess those things to you. And then you just identify and you name it. You say it. You just say it. God, I am a gossiper. I cannot shut my mouth. I love morsels of nasty little gossip and I tell other people as fast as I can and I just have a horrible, nasty little mouth. Now we're praying, okay? Now we're acknowledging to God our sin. David says, I know my transgressions, my sins always before. He says, I know what it is. Have you gotten to that place? God, I am greedy. I love money. I think more about money, God, than I think about you. And I think more about stuff than I think about the stuff of your kingdom. Help me, God. I'm so about stuff. I'm so greedy. Not one amen in the room. Delayed. But thank you. You know, God, I'm a luster. I just lust. My eyes look for stuff that I know I shouldn't be looking at. And I go through channels, or I click the mouse, or I go places, and I just, my mind goes where it shouldn't go. And God, my mind can be so nasty and so profane and so lustful. God, forgive me. I acknowledge my sin to you. Start there. I don't know what your sin is, but talk to God about it, because you know and he knows. And acknowledge it. Part of the process of walking in holiness is acknowledging where we're not walking in holiness. Number three, look honestly at the consequences of your sins and admit that all sin breaks the heart, breaks God's heart, hurts us, and impacts others. All sin breaks the heart of God. Listen to Galatians chapter 6, verses 7 and 8. Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. You can't fool God. You can't mock God. A man, a person, reaps what he sows. Whoever sows to their flesh, from their flesh will reap destruction. Well, my sin doesn't have any consequences. You know, my sin, it's just between me and nobody else. Nobody knows. Nobody's caught me. So it doesn't have any consequences, right? Wrong. Every sin has consequences. Try this one on for size. Try this one on. Here's one consequence of sin. It put Jesus on the cross. Is that a big deal? Our sin was part of what put nails to the feet of the perfect Lamb of God and nails to the hands of the perfect Lamb of God, our sins. Well, my sin doesn't hurt anybody. Yes, it does. It hurts you. And it keeps you from being who God wants you to be, and that impacts every relationship you have. Every sin has consequences. Acknowledge them. And say to yourself, if I get caught for this sin, what will the consequences be? Or better yet, when I get caught for this, because we always get caught. What's the consequence going to be? And let that move you to run and flee from sin. Number four, how do I grow in the health and wholeness of holiness? Embrace godly sorrow and humble repentance. Take responsibility for your sin and your rebellion. Just embrace, let your heart be broken. Let tears flow. God, I don't want to be this kind of woman. I don't want to be this kind of man. I don't want to be this kind of young person. I don't want to be that person. My heart is broken over my sin. Let your heart be broken, because it breaks the heart of God. Psalm 32:5 says this, then I acknowledge my sins to you. I didn't cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. And you forgave the guilt of my sin. To say, God, my heart's broken over my sin. And if it's not, to pray, God, break my heart over this sin. I'm trying to strive to live for you. I'm not going to do it perfectly, but I want to long to live for you. And I want to have my heart broken when I fall short and live in impurity. Number five, go to war on sin. Go to war on sin. Listen to this. Make serious, targeted, laser precision attacks on the sin areas of your life. Don't be comfortable with your sin. Don't just be bothered, listen to this, but hate your sin the way God hates it. Hate sin. Hate your sin. So I don't want to be a hateful person. Yes, you do when it comes to sin. There's a little saying that Christians love. We love this little saying. We love to quote this little saying. I think it's true, but I think we quote it too lightly. Here's the saying. I'll give the first half. You give me the second half, okay? God hates the sin, but he loves the sinner. Okay? It's all true. But you know what part we jump to really quickly? Loves the sinner. You know what part we don't linger on very long? God hates the sin. He hates our sin. He hates it so much, he died for it. He hates our sin. You know why? Because our sin destroys us. Because our sin tears us to pieces. Because our sin destroys our families. Because our sin breaks his heart. Because our sin drives us away from him. He hates sin, and we should hate sin too. We have a lot of military in our church. We love the military in our church. We have a lot of military. Man, go to war on sin. Go to war on sin. And actually say, I don't want to live that way. I don't. And this laser targeted, that's my sin. I admit it. I confess it. I'm fighting against it. Don't become comfortable with it. Hate it and go after it. and fight against it. Listen to Colossians chapter 3, verses 5. And if you don't like that hate language, if you don't like that battle language, listen to Colossians 3, 5 to 8. Here's how it begins. Put to death. Sounds like killing stuff, doesn't it? Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature. Sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. God hates sin. Listen to this. You used to walk in these ways, in the life you once lived, but now you must rid yourselves of all these, all such things as these. Get rid of them. Deal with them. And so look and say, where do I have to battle against sin? Name the high place, acknowledge it, confess it, and say, I'm going to war against sin in my life. I'm not sitting by complacently anymore and letting sin control me. Because you know what? I belong to Jesus. Amen? I don't belong to sin anymore. And so I'm going to go to war and to fight against it. How do I grow in the health and wholeness of holiness? Number 6, realize that there is a power much greater than your sin and your temptation. His name is Jesus. Amen? His name is Jesus, and he is with you and you always in the person of the Holy Spirit. The Spirit of God lives in you. When you come to God through faith in Jesus, when you come to that place where Jesus died, paid the price, he was the great high priest, he was the lamb that takes away the sins of the world, he died on the cross, he sat down, he paid it all, and when you receive him, listen to this, the Holy Spirit of God moves into you. The Holy Spirit of God Almighty, the holy, holy, holy God moves into you. And he who is in you, the Bible says, is greater than he who is in the world. He's greater than the enemy. He's greater than Satan. We're going to spend a whole week talking just about this 2 weeks from now. We're going to be a series called Victory. Our Easter series this year is called Victory. It's going to be a celebration of the victory we have in Jesus. So we're going to talk real in detail about this part of the battle and battling sin. But to realize that there's power much greater than your sin. Listen to Romans chapter 6, verses 12 to 14. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body. You're done with that, man. You are done with that. Don't let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its evil desires. Do not offer any part of yourself, not your pinky finger, not your toe. Don't let any part of yourself. Don't offer it to sin as an instrument of wickedness, but rather offer yourselves, all of you, to God as those who have been brought from death to life. And offer every part of yourself to him as an instrument of righteousness. For sin shall no longer be your master. You are not under the law, but under grace. There is a power in you greater than your sin. His name is Jesus. And his Spirit moved in, and his Spirit is not leaving. So walk in that power and walk in that strength. Now, let's get really practical. 6 more thoughts. 6 more ideas about growing in the health and the wholeness of holiness. Number 7, read, study, memorize, and agree with the Bible. God's word is your sword for the battle. Know this book. This is a Shoreline Bible here. We give these away. If you don't have a Bible and you want one today on your retina, and if you're on, whether you're at Monday night or whether you're at Pacific Grove or wherever you are, if you're online and you want a Bible, let us know. We'll send one to you. We buy these Bibles and we use your offering, your giving back money, to give Bibles away. Anybody got a problem with that? No, you don't, right? And so if you need a Bible, you go to the Connection Center today and say, yeah, can I have one of those Shoreline Bibles? These are the exact words of the Bible I use every week when I preach. If you want a fancier one with nice leather and stuff, go to the cafe and you can buy one. But we'll give you one for free. All the same words, okay? But get to know this book. Study this book. Read this book. Get it in your mind. Get it in your heart. Have it on your lips. Do what it says. And that's not always easy. I mean, I became a Christian out of a totally non-Christian pagan background. Someone gave me a Bible. I had no background, no history. So when I first started reading the Bible, I didn't understand most of it. But there were parts of it I did understand. And those worked me over. Showed me how to live in a way I wasn't living. And called me to try to follow Jesus, and taught me that when I fell and struggled and came short, to get back up and keep following, because his power is still in me. Get to know this book. And we have all kinds of classes and learning opportunities and growth groups where we study the Bible. Get it and open this book every day. Or if you're not a good reader, if you don't enjoy reading, go online, click on the Shoreline website, and click on the daily reading, and have your phone read it to you, or have your iPad read it to you. You ready for this? That counts. All right? Just get the word of God in your mind, in your heart, and in your life. And Psalm 119, longest chapter in the Bible, completely devoted to what the Bible's about. We read this. How can a young person stay on the path of purity? By living according to your word. Then verse 11. I have hidden your word in my heart. Listen to this. That I might not sin against you. Get to know the word of God. If you don't know where to start, call the church and we'll get you in a class, a growth group, a learning experience. We want you to know this word and then live it out. Number 8. How do I grow in the health and the wholeness of holiness? Become a student of Satan's tactics and enticements. In general, specifically in your life and in your family history. Get to know the tactics and the enticements of Satan. And study what he does. Know your enemy. And you'll begin to walk in victory. We're going to dig into this in great detail 2 weeks from now in the victory series. But in 1 Peter 5, 8 to 9, we read this. Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, listen to this, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith. Know the tactics of the enemy. Well, how do I do that? Go back to the last point. Read the book. Because you know what? Satan hasn't changed his tactics very much because they still work really well. But you can know how he attacks. And again, we're going to dig into that in the next series we're going to be digging into. But also, let me challenge you to look at your own life. There's two main ways that Satan is going to attack you in your life. I don't know what areas, but I know there's two main ways. Number one, he's going to go to the areas that you've sinned a bunch in the past. Because there's these really familiar ruts in your heart and in your life and in your neural pathways that you can fall right in and just start rolling down that road again. The same thing you've done 1,000 times that you said you're never doing again, and there you are doing it again. Satan's going to invite you right down that same road. Be ready for that. But the other one is this. Satan's going to entice you to sin in an area that you think you'll never sin. Oh, I'd never do that. Be careful. Be careful. I sat with a friend of mine, pastor buddy of mine, for 20 years of ministry, great friends. And he explained how he was leaving his ministry, leaving his wife, and leaving his kids. For a woman who was leaving her ministry and leaving her husband and leaving her kids. Because they'd gotten involved in a sexual affair and they found their soulmate and they were truly in love for the first time, so they thought. And so they ran off, destroyed their ministries, their families, and they lived happily ever after for 6 months. And then everything blew up for them too. But he told me, he said, I would have told you 3 months before that all happened, it would never happen to me. And that's one of the reasons it happened. When you don't think it's going to happen, you know what you do? You drop your guard. Watch the familiar paths and watch the areas you think you would never sin and never struggle. And then watch your family history. Study your family history. There are family sins that you can be drawn into. We're going to look at that more in the victory series too. But there are family sins and family patterns that all of a sudden you go, I'd never be like that. And all of a sudden you go, I am like that. Or you don't know you're like that until your kids tell you, no, you're just like grandpa. You're just like grandma. You're just like that. And you go, no, I'm not. And you go, I am. So watch your family history and watch the tactics of the enemy. Become a student of the enemy so you can fight against him. Number 9, reduce your exposure to the things that cause temptation in your life and run when you must. Discover the things that create temptation. Identify them and stay away from them. If you have a problem with alcoholism and drinking and hanging out in the bar with friends who keep wanting you to drink is a difficult place to be, can I give you a really wise suggestion? Don't go there, right? If you struggle with drug addiction and you're around people who still struggle with addictions and they keep inviting you in, watch those. You may have to break off those relationships at least for a season and get into a group like Celebrate Recovery or into a 12-step group where there's accountability and prayer and encouragement. Get people and fight against it. If you're a gossip, watch those people that just feed the gossip to you, whatever it is. There's this wonderful little passage in 2 Timothy 2. It's easy to remember 2 Timothy 2:22. It takes two people, in most cases, to commit most sins. 2 Timothy 2:22. It says this, flee the evil desires of youth. Flee, run, and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace, along with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. Flee the evil desires of youth. Don't be ashamed to run away. Be glad that you have the strength to run away. I was listening to a guy speak. He's kind of an iconic business. He's a Christian business leader, well-known in the business world, well-known in the Christian business world. And older than me, and he says, you know, when I go away on the road to travel for business, he says, I'm tempted to get involved in pornography. Because every hotel I'm in has a TV. And every TV I turn on has little advertisements. Late at night. Nighttime stuff for adults only. And he says, once I start watching sports, then I kind of see that. And he's admitting to all these young leaders, all these young business leaders, I struggle with this. He says, here's what I do now. He says, when I go into the room, I take a towel. He says, I hang it over the TV. Then I take a picture of me and my wife. And I set it in front of the towel. He says, if I'm feeling really tempted, I set my Bible next to it. He says, that's what I do. Now, he says, you might think that I'm weak, but he says, you'd be right. But I got to run. I got to put up my defenses. How do you run? How do you put up your defenses? Use wisdom and run from those things that you're enticed into. Number 10, dare to set up radical and serious systems of accountability, even when it hurts. Get accountable. Women, get one or two women in your life who will ask you how you're doing, who will tell you the truth, who will speak to you and speak truth to you because they love you. Men, find one or two men who love you, who love Jesus, and who will speak the truth. And ask them, will you help me? Will you keep me? Ask me how I did when I was out on the road. Ask me how I'm doing with my mouth and what I'm saying to people. Ask me how I'm doing with my bitterness and my anger. Ask me how I'm doing with my temper. Whatever it is, ask me once a week, how are you doing? And then when I tell you how I'm doing and I make it sound pretty good, look at me and say, tell me the truth. How are you really doing? Get accountability. Do you have anyone in your life like that? I love the story of Daniel. And there's a point where Daniel is not dealing with a temptation, but he's dealing with a really difficult situation. And the Bible says, Daniel returned to his house and explained the matters to his friends, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. And he urged them to plead for mercy from the God of heaven. This is Daniel chapter 2. Daniel had a couple of friends that when it was tough, he said, I can go to them. And they're going to pray for me. Whether it's striving for a good thing or fighting against a bad thing. Do you have anyone in your life who will pray for you like that? Will ask you the hard questions. And here's the answer. You do. You do have people like that in your life. You just have to invite them in and invite them to have that role and to walk with you. Two more thoughts. Number 11. Replace habits of impurity with holy and God-honoring habits. Fast from sin as you feast on righteousness. We're going to talk about this in the Victory series also. But the idea is simply to look and say, if I've got an area where I'm drawn into impurity and I tend to do impure things, what if I not only just fight against that thing, what if I replace it with something righteous, something good, something beautiful? So if I'm drawn into watching this kind of stuff, let me find something good to watch or something good to pour into my mind. And if I have a problem with my mouth with gossiping, what if I start to bless and encourage instead? Every time I want to gossip, I stop and say, no, I'm going to say something positive. And replace the ungodly, impure stuff with righteous, good stuff. To be intentional, to work at that. I love these words from Psalm 24. Who may ascend to the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not trust in the idol or swear by false gods. Not idols or false gods, but seeking the face of God. Out with the idols, in with worship of God. Replace the bad stuff with something good that honors God. And then finally, how do I grow in the health and wholeness of holiness? Embrace grace when you struggle and rejoice as you take steps of faithfulness. Know that because Jesus, the great high priest, paid the price, died on the cross, gave the final sacrifice, and sat down and said, it's finished. Know that you're forgiven if you come to him and you're made holy. But as you strive to grow in holiness, know that there's times you're going to fall. There's times you're going to struggle. But listen to these words from Ephesians 2, verses 4 and 5. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, I love that, he's rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. When you struggle, when you fall, when you're striving and seeking to live for Jesus and to walk in purity and walk away from sin, and when you fall, remember you can always come back to Jesus. He's not left you, and you're made holy because of what he did. So you end where we started in point one. Point one, we're on our knees fighting the flow of our impure culture, crying out to God. And number 12, we're back on our knees. And we're saying, God, I've been trying to live for you. I've been trying to grow in holiness. And I've fallen again. Remind me of your grace. Remind me that I'm still your child. I'm still your son. I'm still your daughter. I'm still loved by you. That you made me holy on the cross. Remind me of your grace so I can stand up and follow you again. God, that's what we pray right now, Lord. We pray that you would help us to begin on our knees, saying, God, help us grow in holiness. Help us walk and live in holiness. But Lord, help us then stay on our knees so that when we fall and when we struggle, your grace is always enough and you always wash us clean and give us a new beginning. Thank you, Jesus, for doing it all on the cross, for paying the price for us, so that when we fall and struggle, we still remain holy because of what you've done for us and in us. We pray this in your name. Amen. I want to encourage you this week to keep seeking God and seeking to grow in holiness. I want to hand off right now to our online community, to those who are in our military and online, and I want to say they're going to have a few announcements following this right now. And here in the worship center, just one invitation I want to give you. I want to invite you to head out with us right now outside for baptisms. I think we have 3 baptisms going on in about 3 or 4 or 5 minutes. If you have a kiddo upstairs in the children's programming, please get them first. Don't forget them. Grab them and then come out and just stand up on the top side and all around. There's some chairs. Join us there and we're going to join together to celebrate baptism. If you want prayer, there's folks up here for prayer. And also, if you are new at Shoreline on your way out for baptism, just pop by the Connection Center and tell them you're new. They want to give you a gift. Thank you for coming and answer your questions. So we'll see you outside for baptism and have a great week. Hi there.
Hey, how are you?
Doing great.